Hello, my friend. I'm at the Takeover Super Show in Anaheim, California, the biggest lowrider car show event every year in the world. Come with me now as I celebrate and honor this truly unique, wonderful Mexican American Los Angeleno culture and art form. You're gonna love it. My friend, I think you've got one of the most beautiful Impalas I've ever seen. So one of my favorite things about the best lowrider cars is the paintings and the artwork on it. And I think you've got probably my favorite car I've ever seen in any lowrider show. What is it specifically, all the places on your car? Is that like the places that you like to display the car, like Whittier Boulevard and the Hustler Casino?
So I'm born and raised here in LA.
Okay.
And these places are my backyard. These are places that I visit, I go to. I lived in Watts, I go to Hollywood Cruising.
I love the Watts Towers, it's great.
The Staples Center per se is just, it's a staple of LA. It represents where I'm from. So all the places you see on this, there's Vegas on there too.
Yeah.
But like you said, yeah, it is places where this car has been.
So it's like it's all personal history with the different
paintings. Synonymous with what I've been with this car with.
There must be artists who do specifically the painting.
So that's a great question. There is a lot of artists that do this specific work for these cars. So, you know, you get to them, you tell them your idea, and you kind of write it down on paper, and you take it from there. But all the intricate details, it kind of comes from their minds. You tell them what you want, how you want it.
So there's a guy who's like specifically does like chrome work and stuff like this.
Yeah, specifically chrome work, specifically the engraving. You see all the engraving on there?
Yeah.
There's a specific guy that does the striping. So the striping guy doesn't do this.
Got it.
This is an artist. This is a pinstriper. There's a guy that does the engines. You know, specific things to specific parts of the car. Yeah, these are all works of art here, and they're all beautiful, and no one car is the same.
Look how many batteries he's got in the trunk. That's how much power it takes a car like that to bounce. Amazing.
If you're the usual car owner, these cars may look like junk to you, something you'd pay somebody $25 just to tow away. You shouldn't do that. This is a 1950 Ford. It was running when Joe Limonis bought it for about $400. Now he's making a low rider out of it, and when he's through, it will sell for not quite three times what it was worth when it was sold brand new. And it was sold brand new for $1,539.86. Joe got it from the original owner, complete with owner's manual and sales invoice.
White people really freak out. You guys are like, you know, they're going to take your job. They're going to take your job, right? As if you're going to go to work and there's going to be a Mexican sitting in your cubicle, you know? I took your job.
Willie Barcena, ladies and gentlemen, comedy legend, man I love. I want to talk to you about lowrider culture because I was in Japan 10 years ago and I saw all these lowrider dudes and these Japanese guys in Osaka, Japan.
Yeah.
They were dressed the way that
like homies,
Mexican gangbangers would dress in the 80s with the flannel shirt. They got like the dark Dickies pants. Right. They got the plaid Pendletons, but only the top two buttons, and then the clean white T-shirt underneath it, and the hairnet.
Yeah.
And these dudes are Japanese.
Yeah.
They live on the other, and they had lowrider cars, and I always liked cars, and I always thought that was like the highest art for a car. Yeah. But when I went to Japan and I saw this, it was just like it blew me away. The impact.
Yeah. I don't know if you know how. The reason lowriders came to be,
tell me the story,
is because back in the day, man, the Mexican kids could not afford the new car, you know? So they always bought old cars that were like, somebody would junk them. The same thing with the clothes from the 40s, the zoot suit.
Yeah.
It became a style, but the reason they had those coats because it was their dad's coats. They couldn't afford new suits. So they made it hip to wear their dad's clothes. We got like a 16-year-old skinny kid wearing his grandfather's suit.
One thing I read about how lowrider culture started was that a lot of men returned from World War II, and they had learned all about engines and working on engines, but also like welding and doing all this different stuff that they had to do in the war effort. And then when they returned, you know, you had hot rod culture taking off.
Right.
Where all these people were like, you know, taking old cars, souping them up, making them super fast. You know, I guess like the white community.
Right, right.
They're making hot rods and they're racing. Whereas in the Mexican community, you don't want to go fast. You want to slow down and be among your community.
Right.
And that's why the cars went so low, because so that they could go really slow. And show off
the ride, yeah.
Yeah. One thing I think is that it's one of the true American art forms. Like, jazz came from Harlem, stand-up comedy started in America, and the lowrider culture of Los Angeles. Like, those are like the main true American art forms.
Yeah.
And the amount of money and the artwork, like these, a lot of these cars are just masterpieces.
One, two, three, ho!
Cindy Avila, you are a significant person in Los Angeles history because you started the first female lowrider club?
Well, not the first.
Okay.
There's been a couple of other ones out there.
Sandy's a legend.
Yes, she is.
And your club is called the Lady Lowriders.
Lady Lowrider Car Club. Right now we have 10 members, and each member is actually based out of a different area throughout California. So I'm here based out of Pasadena. I have a member out in the high desert, Riverside, Orange County, Fresno, Oxnard.
Wow, all right, so that's far reaching.
Yes.
Lowrider culture can be kind of a male dominated thing.
Definitely.
And that, I mean, you're kind of like a feminist icon. You're a true badass woman, and that's why I wanted to talk to you.
I appreciate that. It's a trip because when I started lowriding, I did it because it was like, I saw a couple women out there. And to be honest, I didn't think it at that time that it was okay, per se, for women to lowride.
Oh, really?
I didn't. I remember when I wanted a car and me and my husband talked about it, I was a little scared because I was like, how are the men gonna take that? I've only learned about more women because of what I've done. You know what I'm saying? Like kind of doing my research and learning about women in lowriding. That's how I've learned, because I never really saw it.
So were you looking for a Cutlass Supreme, or that's the car that you...
You know what? I was actually looking for a Regal because my mom had a Regal back in the day, so that's what I wanted.
Yeah.
But I couldn't find one at the time, so I ended up buying this one. I have a Regal now that I'm building. I actually have an Impala as well that I'm building.
Wow. Why the Chevy Impala specifically? What is it about that car that lowrider people love so much?
You know what? Honestly, I can't answer for everybody, but I know that it's a beautiful car. It's a beautiful car. The body, the lines, the look of the car, it's just, they're beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah, I feel like the original lowriders, in my opinion, are the Impalas. It's like a therapy. That's what I kind of compare it to the most, or what it means to me. Like, of course, it's the culture, but when I get in my car and I low ride, it's a form of therapy for me. And I know a lot of people too, because I do hear a lot of people say that. Just getting in your car, putting your tunes on, whatever you want to hear, whether you like the old school funk, oldies, hip hop, cruising in your car, and you know, that's it. It's like, that's what it's all about at the end of the day too.
Howdy, y'all. Bobby Rodriguez, this is one of the most beautiful cars I've ever seen in my life.
Thank you.
What kind of car is this?
This is a 1937 Buick Roadmaster.
How did you fall in love with lowrider culture?
You know what, since I was a kid, I was born and raised in LA, and there was a car club there in LA, like within blocks away from where we used to live. And as kids, we used to go and check out the cars and see the older guys drive the old bombs. And that's how I fell in love with them. As soon as I turned 18, that was my first car, was a 1937 truck.
So you were determined from the time you were a kid.
I'm gonna get one.
I'm gonna get one as soon as I can possibly get one.
Right. My first car I got, I think I paid like $500 for it. And I started working on it. First thing I did, took all the leaf springs, dropped it. And put a sun visor and started working on it.
How much work did you put into this car?
A lot of work. We did all the interior, rewired it, motor. Man, we did a lot of work into it. It was running when I got it, but it was running very, very bad.
So did it have this original paint job? Did you?
Well, the paint, it is original. We buffed it and polished it as best as we could, and we redid all the chrome is redone.
One thing I know about car culture, having a classic car, is that it takes a lot of money to maintain and restore a classic car. So you must have poured thousands and thousands of dollars into this car.
Well, now we do. If you want to have an old car, now you do spend thousands of dollars, like you said. Back in the days, we used to get these cars because that was the only thing available for the Chicano culture, because we didn't have a lot of money. So we would get the old cars that were very affordable, $300-$400, and paint them and fix them up, drop them, and make them look as best we could.
Yes!
That's the name of my car, Master of the Game.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, they didn't have seatbelts in 1937, huh?
Nope, they started in the 70s. And then press the button. You're in. That's it, it's on?
It's on. Look at that smile. You know what? It feels manly to drive this kind of car. The shifting feels manly, the power steering.
No power steering. But this was chauffeur driven, so whoever owned it had money. Yeah, they've been telling me, bag it. I don't know if I'm gonna cut it. I don't think I wanna cut into the frame. Not yet, at least. That's what makes it a low rider, slow, because you gotta slow down on the whole now, because it's not gonna hit somewhere. You'll leave your muffler behind.
Woohoo! That was awesome.
Farther we go into
low riding,
it starts to develop into more different art form now than original back when we first started. You know, it was just like solid colors and lower wheels, the small wheels, lower cars. Now they have, and then the hydraulics came in after like around the 70s.
Yeah, when did, I've always, that fascinates me. When did they feel the need to start bouncing?
Like in the, I believe it was like the 70s or so, or maybe 60s when the guys used to go to, I believe it was Boeing where they make the airplanes, a Boeing, and get the hydraulics. They would have hydraulics. Whatever the airplanes didn't use anymore, they would dump them on the side. Yeah. And the guy would go and buy the pumps and all that and bring them and put them on their cars. That's how they got the hydraulics on them. I mean, and...
Who first thought of that? What a genius idea. Like, your pimp-ass car isn't enough. Let's just really...
Well, remember what you just mentioned a minute ago, that a lot of guys came from the war, so they used to be airplane mechanics, some of them. So they knew all about the hydraulics, how you made the wheels come down and all that. So just incorporated into their own car. And that's how he started, going to Boeing factory. And all the older guys would say, hey, go to Boeing and go get some parts. They would go and get the pumps and get the cylinders and start working on them. And this is my favorite feature of the car, my pipe.
Hey, I'm at the very first Urban Con at the LA Convention Center to honor one of the most uniquely Los Angeles and uniquely American art forms, and that is the lowrider culture of Los Angeles. Hey, I'm with Daniel Martinez, who's with Garcia Signature Hats. Now, Daniel, how did this look become kind of the signature look of lowrider culture? The fedora hats and the plaid shirts.
The fedoras and the derbies and stuff started back in like the 1940s, 50s, and stuff like that. A lot of people loved to wear them.
In that zoot suit era, back in that.
Yeah, it stems off of that, you know what I mean? And it's just modernized as it's gone on, you know? You can't be a lowrider without a hat.
Alfredo, I have to say, your 1999 Nissan pickup truck is my favorite vehicle at this event.
Thank you, man. I appreciate it. I got that truck for 33 years, man.
How long did it take you to do all the artwork and details and the hydraulics on the back of the truck?
I bought it in 1989 and I come out on Lowrider Magazine in 1992. That was ready for magazine.
It blows my mind. Has it been in magazines?
Yes. Lowrider Magazine, it was there 1992 and then 1995 from then.
That's Lowrider Magazine's got to be the holy grail of lowrider culture, right?
Yes. Yes.
If you're in there, it's like the major leagues. And you showed me that the women that are on the truck are actually real women that they were modeled after.
Clarissa Mendez, yes. She lives in Rancho Cucamonga.
My favorite, I'm blown away by your truck and I'm looking at all the details. And then after I came around, I noticed on the inside on the passenger seat by the footboard is two wine holders and some wine glasses. Like, come on, that is like, that's the pimpest touch to a lowrider I've ever seen.
That's me and kids, that way you like that truck, you can go and get a shot right there. That's for you guys.
How much money do you think you've invested in that car through the years?
Right now, the way it is, probably like $70,000.
Wow, worth every cent. I absolutely, Alfredo, it's an honor to meet you. Mucho gusto, mi hermano. And thank you for making such a beautiful masterpiece. I just had the honor of meeting Tanya Estrada, and I heard you're a stand-up comedian.
I am. I'm a stand-up comedian.
I'm a comedian also.
You are.
We're in the same tribe. Did you grow up in Los Angeles around lowrider culture?
I was born in Los Angeles, actually. My parents moved me over to like Harvard and Kingsley off of like Pico for a while, And then they thought it was a really good idea to get away to the suburbs and get away from the gangs and move to La Puente. But little did they know that everybody had already left LA and moved to La Puente.
What do you think the rest of the world should know about lowrider culture?
One thing you should know about lowrider culture is if you see a beautiful car that you love, be sure to find the owner and compliment him on his work, because he's gone through a lot of work. Two, don't get on the hood like you're a lowrider model. You damn well know you've been in the pandemic and you haven't weighed yourself in a long time. You'll be fucking up people, so don't do that either. If you can, be sure to BYOB, which means bring your own beer in your trunk, because we do these white people events and shit's expensive, you know what I mean? So it's my baby daddy over here. Hold on one second. The child support will be there next month.
Do you have any more jokes related to lowrider culture?
Any more jokes? No, because I don't want to get my ass beat. So I'm just going to walk away with that. All right, everybody. Love, peace, and chicken grease.
Hey, I'm here with Loretta Vamps. You're an actress. You're in a movie.
Cholo Zombie Monstro. It's coming out this summer. Yes, I'm an actress, model, and a fashion designer. I'm here representing, I'm a Chola clown today. My makeup was done by my friend Carlo Vera, and then I put this getup together myself. And I like to be a little more exaggerated than the normal clown.
I've always been afraid of clowns, but I feel at ease around you.
So I actually started as a model, modeling with cars. I grew up in Los Angeles, and I grew up with low riders, and I started off as a pinup model, modeling with cars.
So have you been in Lowrider Magazine?
And yeah. I've been in some magazines, but all Los Angeles, big community of cars.
But I love how, you know, it's associated with beautiful women. And
we can go together.
Yeah.
That's what's up.
Did you make a lot of money being a lowrider model?
Yes, I did. That's where I started. That's what started me, is doing the model. I'm very creative as a fashion designer. And I kind of used myself to use my fashion. And then I was just a natural.
For the uninitiated people around the world that might see this, what do you think is so unique and special about lowrider culture in Los Angeles?
The cars are completely different, like the artwork, the murals on the cars, the pinstriping, the style of the rim, just the color coordinations. It's very unique. LA has definitely their own original look. And they're actually inspired by a lot of people like Japan.
That's what I was telling people. About 10 years ago, I was in Osaka, and these Japanese guys had mimicked LA Mexican culture. Not only did they have pimped out Impalas, they had like the dress with the plaid shirts with just the two buttons, and it was like mind blowing that that this is how they dress in Japan. And it's, you know, from Los Angeles.
And also too, the motorcycle culture is also becoming very like the cars. The motorcycle culture, they have murals and same thing. I'm doing a show next week called Biclassos, which is gonna be a whole show of motorcycles, which I'm doing the fashion show with women bike riders, and you would like it, because it's also LA culture.
What do you think the rest of the world should know about lowrider culture in Los Angeles?
What they should know about lowriders, that it's life. Like, just having a beautiful car, it's like when you're collecting something, it's just meaningful and it's just beautiful. If you see every car is different. What they put in there is so much love. It's beautiful.
You're the first clown I'm not afraid of, so. What is your Instagram so people can follow you?
I'm under Loretta Vamps.
With a Z.
With a Z. Thank you so much, and thank you for coming to UrbanCon.
Loretta, thank you so much. It's an honor to speak with you. Thank you very much. Great culture anywhere you go in Europe, but you know what they don't have? Bouncing cars.